I think it's amazing you've all hung in here. I want to give you a round of applause for hanging in there this long. I'm reminded of a man who came out of his bathroom with the tissue up to his face, and his wife said, what's wrong? And he said, oh, I was concentrating on my speech and I cut my face. And she said, you should have been concentrating on your face and cut your speech. So a lot of the things that we're going to be talking about today, you've heard, but hopefully we're going to present them in this last hour in a little different way, and hopefully we can have some fun as well as learn something new about the process. One thing that is not on my vita, that I don't put on my vita, is in 1989, May 1st, I went out running in the morning, had a great run around the zoo here in Salt Lake City, came home, and was seeing my first patient at 8:30 in the morning, and had what I thought was a heart attack. Could not function, broke out in a sweat, could not think. They rushed me up to the hospital, and 2 years later, I was diagnosed with chronic fatigue. So I am one of you, 18 years into it, and still breathing, still living, still functioning. Chronic fatigue immune deficiency, and I like the immune deficiency because I believe we truly do have a significant immune component to this and a lack of immunity, and the more I study my own experience in those patients which I am blessed to treat with this disorder, I find that immune deficiency component has a great deal to do with our symptoms. It is a multi-system, multi-organ disease process. Fibromyalgia sufferers have many of the same symptoms and difficulties that we will be addressing. One thing that I've had with this disorder is if I looked in that computer for an hour presenting to you, I would be blinded. So I've got just the old paper, the black and white in front of me, and Angela, who will be going back to Washington representing all of us, will be helping me with the computer presentation. Also, I believe in self-care, so I will sit down during some of my presentation. We are all familiar with the general symptoms of CFS and fibromyalgia. It is my hope to assist chronic fatigue sufferers and fibromyalgia sufferers in experiencing new strategies which may aid in coping with the disease and functionally impact the illness instead of having the illness continue to negatively impact us. The symptoms of this disease seem endless. Let's attempt to take a new look at a few of them. My hope is not to discourage you, but to be honest with the realities of the disease and openly address the many emotions and physical limitations that confront us as we live with chronic illness. Let's first look at fatigue. Now, I've had fatigue explained to me as an overwhelming sense of, will I ever be able to revive from this assault or attack that seems to come out of nowhere? I have heard it explained to me that it is as if some unknown masochistic stranger is lurking somewhere who operates a remote control that, when pushed at random intervals, drains all the energy and life out of the sufferer in an instant. Does it sound familiar to anyone? Or like a 3-inch hole has been punched out of our helium balloon. There is no mysterious stranger lurking in the shadows and creating the havoc that accompanies this illness. However, I understand the helplessness we feel at the onset of fatigue associated with CFS and FM. The accompanying pain, nausea, and illness that escalates immediately without warning or without a release valve comes with the fatigue. This fatigue is like no other, is like no other I have seen in my 30 plus years of working with individuals with chronic illness and life-threatening disease. CFS fatigue is pervasive, relentless, and never completely resolved by rest, diet, medication, or altered states of consciousness. In other words, for most of us, it is always with us. What doesn't work? Everything we were trained to do from our childhood associated with onset of illness, its accompanying pain, and the multiple medical and physical symptoms that go with it, like seeking medical help, taking 2 aspirin and going to bed, getting more rest, discontinuing our normal daily routine, and being compliant in taking our prescribed medications, do not alleviate the overwhelming fatigue that accompanies the onset of these multi-system disease processes. In other words, what we have been taught to do when we contract other disease processes does not work with CFS or FM. And that's overwhelming to a lot of us because we're going back to what grandma taught us, to what mama taught us. We're going back to all the things we've been taught from this high. If you will only do this, you'll get better. And we keep doing it and we don't get better. Diagnosis. Even after we find ourselves being compliant to the many diagnostic tests we may be asked to go through, and I have to admit, when I was watching some of the earlier presentations, and remember those times I got slid into that MRI, and I heard what sounded like, you know, someone drilling through my brain, the anxiety raised in me, and I went, let me out of here, you know. Get me out of this place. After all the tests are completed, we still don't receive the desired outcome in the hope for doctor's comment that, this is what we want, I have discovered what is ailing you, and after you undergo a certain procedure and a course of medication, and possibly this or that operative procedure, then you will reach the end of the disease process and once again return to your normal self and get your old health back. Didn't you wish for that? Oh, I used to come home and say to my wife, oh, she'd say, well, did you find out anything great? And I'd say, no, didn't find anything great. Found out a lot of things not so great, but nothing great. And I'd go in my bathroom and cry while taking a shower so my kids couldn't hear me. What we too often hear instead is that we have a chronic illness, which at this time has no major orthodox prescribed treatment, and the course of the disease is of an unknown duration and etiology. It is also a disease without a proven treatment, procedure, or known cure. We can treat symptoms and certain aspects of the disease, however, there is not yet a cure. You've heard it a million times, just wanted to make sure you heard it again. With these words ringing in our ears, we feel many conflicting emotions and feel confusion of what do we do now? There must be someone who knows more about this disease than these group of doctors or these health professionals I'm messing with. Anger can often set in, and many newly diagnosed patients start an expensive, often unfruitful, confusing journal into unproven or alternative medical treatments, herbal remedies, depression, disillusionment, and more loss. Now, are you ready to go home? I hope not, because now we're going to get positive. I don't have trail mix, but I have water that just went down the wrong tube. The effects on those of us, these are some of the reasons our caregivers and families have such a difficult time in understanding what it is they should do for us. What is it we with the disease can or cannot do? That's a hard question for our caregivers. Should I push him? Should I not push him? Should I let him sleep? Should I get him up and have him walk with me? Should I have him eat this? Should I not? They don't know. What helps us and what hurts us, and like us, they are asking, will they ever get their spouse, friend, and loved one back from this perplexing journey? All who are touched with CFS and fibromyalgia must learn new levels of compassion and flexibility never before plumbed, except for those who suffer from and with chronic disease. Understanding their role and ours in supporting and caregiving those of us with the illness take a long time. Give your support people the time they need, for they are grieving as we are grieving. Allow them to grieve the loss of what we were. This is because many of the social and emotional responses that we have learned about living with illness and having other disease do not work with chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia. However, we must not give up or give in to the process. It does not get better without our active intervention. If we give up, it won't give up on us. It will take everything we allow it to take. We must stand up to it and say, sorry, I'm not going to allow you to have all of me. Weakness. How many are feeling that right now? Weakness. CFS-related weakness can stop us dead in our tracks and usually happens at the most inopportune times. This weakness can be transitory in nature. Sometimes with time and learning, we gain knowledge of how and when we can wait out the weakness or other related symptoms, which allows us to better acclimate to the environment, temperatures, noise levels, and changes which come from every environmental and new social situation we encounter. Do you know what your body's just did in just transitioning from our last speaker to me? Do you realize what happens? And do you know with this disease, we don't transist well? We don't make that transition well. It is a whole brand new structure every time we have a transition. So it's different when you're talking to your daughter on the phone than when you're talking to your uncle or your sister, because our bodies react to the stimulus in a different way than they used to react. And each person creates a different process, and I'll try and get to that, okay? As we gain understanding of these factors, we can learn to have more satisfying social interactions with fewer and fewer major disruptive symptoms, which cause us too frequently to abort the activity midstream or even before it gets started. For example, theater attendance, grocery shopping, entertaining, entering public buildings, or going out to eat. Well, let's talk a little bit about what Suzanne talked about, okay? She spoke about reactions to the immune activation with the fluctuation. What immune activation do you experience when you go to the theater? What happens in your mind when you think, I want to go see a movie? I have to sit there. And what if I have to go to the bathroom? And then I have to get up. And what if my bladder, you know? It's too loud. You know, we sit down and we think, oh, I can't stand that. Or we go in there and we sit next to someone who's really perfumed up, you know? Ever been there? Ever done that, you know? Or we sit down and we finally get used to the temperature. And we finally get used to the reality of the noise blasting in our ear. And we finally get used to the whole structure. And then somebody brings in a hot dog and popcorn, and we smell it, and we have nausea, and we think, I'm going to throw up in 10 minutes. So we say it's not worth it to go to the movie. Been there? Been there? Okay. Our body mechanisms, if we allow them and understand them, can work through that process. I remember all my grandkids wanted me to, and I have eight of them, wanted me to go to Harry Potter. Who would miss Harry Potter? I got in there and I thought, it's the last thing I'm ever going to do in my life. I'm dying on the spot. With all the goblins and all the people and all the noise and that horrible smell of whatever it was the man was eating behind me. So what HTCH factors are going on within me there, eh? Profound a lot. Let's talk a little bit about mind-body. Whoops, did I blow it? Okay, mind-body. Remember that CFS and FM are multi-system disease, which will throw at us many cycles and symptoms to try to protect us, to try and protect us from thinking or believing we can function as we once did. This disease, after a period of time, says, I'm not going to let you do what you used to do. Because if you do it, you're just going to get in trouble. So I'm going to give you profound anxiety, or I'm going to create heart palpitations, or I'm going to make you feel so fibrofog you don't even know where you are, because I'm trying to protect you from yourself. Does that sound familiar? Is that how we expect our minds to behave? No, it isn't. This protective tendency of the mind-body interaction does not always function for our best good. In other words, the mind can't always be trusted. When it thinks it is helping us, it is often lying to us in an effort to protect us from needed risk and needed social interaction. It is often the mind and body telling us not to engage in an activity to try and protect us from what it perceives to be dangerous or anxiety-producing behavior. When this proposed protection is active, we can end up isolating and keeping ourselves from the exact things that can, in the end, create a healthier, less depressive, and less anxious quality of life. If we give into the multi-systems that accompany each situation, the symptoms can severely limit our activity until these same mind-body reactions will convince us, if we allow them, to not allow any healthy, social, emotionally risk-oriented activity at all in our lives. We need to maintain control over the mind-body tendency to over-restrict us from behaviors and interactions that give us the good neurochemicals we need and require to feel better and bring purpose and positive feelings to our relationships. If we need a wheelchair, please get a wheelchair. It can save you so much energy getting to and from the location, class, workstation, or activity. Then once we are there, we can use the energy you have conserved in not walking to and from. We need to get over our pride and our disappointment, which can be attached to not wanting to be seen as disabled. I know far too many sufferers who spend so much of their daily allotment of energy getting to and from locations that no energy is left to enjoy the destination once they have arrived. Life with CFIDS and FM is worth living. However, we need to live it wisely, mindfully, and joyfully. These disease processes have changed us. We must stop expending so much energy in trying to capture what we once were and once what we once had, and appreciate the things about our new self living with chronic disease. Now let's talk about abdominal irritability. The subset of symptoms can fluctuate between extremes in diarrhea to constipation, from irritable bowel to food allergies, from ulcers to gallbladder problems. I bet we have them covered, right, in this room. The abdomen, seems to always be in some flux and often is the source of some discomfort and upset in the life of this illness. Being tied to the bathroom can and does disrupt the lives of far too many sufferers. It can become a major reason for inactivity and lessen social activity, which leads to isolation, anxiety and depression. Colitis and microcolitis are often brought on by a lowered immune response. Any in this room have those diseases? Colitis or microcolitis? I hope you don't get them. Ugh, I have them. They need to be treated by a gastroenterologist to assist the sufferer from the complicated systems associated with these disorders. Let's talk about weight changes for a second. With CFS and FM often comes weight gain or weight loss that makes no sense. It is like our body has acquired a mind of its own and is determined to do what it wants to, never seeking or gaining permission or consent. CFS will take over completely if allowed, just reminding you of that. We must regulate its consumption and the territory we allow it to consume within us. In other words, we must keep this tendency to claim all of us by the disease process in check. We must be the guard and the gatekeeper, only allowing what we will allow to go away from us, never giving CFS a free pass to export and import what it wants to without our close supervision and watch care. Often we must assess what the disease has taken from us this week, or this day, or this month, and purposefully work to take back the ground it has won. Adaptation is the key. It snatches new territory, we recover it. We have to constantly be thinking, what's it taking now? What system is it interrupting now? And regulate and adapt to that structure. And once we do, we feel more in control of just feeling, oh, here's another system it's after now. Often we must recover our losses in ways that are new to us. However, these losses return, we must continue the battle, or we are in danger of losing far too much than the fight. Let's talk about diet. CFS often brings poor appetite or an inability to eat what we used to enjoy and the reality of never knowing what the body will now accept or reject. Our gut, and this is especially true in children and adolescents with this disease, seem to have also joined the rebellion against our will and seem to have acquired minds of its own. Our GI function takes every opportunity to throw us curveballs, get upset, and not function at the least provocation. These dietary fluctuations can and often do change with time, careful watching, and persistent food shuffling. Try new ways to introduce favorite foods back into your diet, or new foods into your diet. Of course, some food allergies are real and set with which we cannot experiment, like wheat allergies, lactose intolerance, or other severe food allergies or reactions. Try to maintain some enjoyable eating practices and behaviors. Try hard to not eliminate all enjoyable aspects of eating. Moderate, enjoyable eating can be something to look forward to and may require recipe changes or adjustments, which will allow you to eat some dishes that would be restricted without the appropriate adjustments or alterations. Eating. High or low blood sugar fluctuations, which can make no reasonable sense, still have the ability to disrupt our thinking and general feelings of well-being. Deborah Robinson, bless her soul, who left us not too long ago, who was my primary care physician, taught me that during times of spaciness and lightheadedness, a rule of thumb is eating fruits and vegetables that grow on the ground, not on the trees. I thought she was insane. I thought, what are you talking about? This practice can decrease the feelings of spaciness or lightheadedness in this sufferer. You will find that certain foods create a groundedness and well-being when our bodies are reacting to these episodes of high and low blood sugars. Eating smaller meals more frequently allows for less hypoglycemic indexes and fewer ups and downs in our blood sugars. So I eat many small meals throughout the day, and I do much better than if I sit down and gorge myself like I used to love to do. Eating what is served at parties or social gatherings that does not agree with our dietary needs or restrictions can create these fluctuations. We need to think that we are not present to eat. However, we are present to interact. We can bring along food that is more suitable to our diets and restrictions and learn to overcome our anxiety of not eating what is served or being fearful of embarrassing our host. People can be very accommodating with just a quick phone call and heads up about our dietary needs. I often eat before an event, so my dietary intake is no longer a necessity at the function, and when possible, I can then graze, Stuart Dresser, I can then graze to see if there is anything being served that would fit my dietary needs. If not, I forgo the eating experience entirely. Take bottled water with you so you can sip it or pour it into the glasses provided at the event and make sure it doesn't go down your windpipe. Body temperature. I wish you could all come put your hand on my forehead about right now. Sweating, which can happen at bedtime, during sleep, when you eat, at meals, when you go to the grocery store, after we bathe and shower, when we sit just alone, minding our own business. Too frequently, I see CFS sufferers avoiding many situations because of pesky perspiration being seen by them as a sign or warning that more serious symptoms are on the horizon, or they are just embarrassed by its randomness. Many CFS sufferers have developed an unreliable temperature gauge or personal thermostat, and our body temperatures can no longer tolerate cold or hot temperatures which we once could. This complication also takes the body more time to adjust to changes in the temperature. Because of this difficulty, we often sweat after bathing or a shower and get very cold at any temperature below 70 degrees. Again, allow the longer adjustment time needed when the body is struggling to acclimate by cooling down or warming up. The body will stop perspiring and it can obtain normalization after a given period of time. Time again is the essence. Often we don't allow ourselves to regulate because we regulate totally different than we used to regulate. It is our task to learn how long that given time period is and not to allow the perspiration to become a detriment in our functional interactions. Layer clothing, which I've seen most of you do, so we can adjust our comfort level without having to leave the activity or not be able to reach an acceptable comfort level when an air conditioning system is far too cold for our comfort or far too hot. Stay hydrated. Stay hydrated. Drink water. you will feel much better with water on board. Dehydration intensifies all the worrisome symptoms of this disease process. Drinking plenty of water is something we all can do. The few more trips to the bathroom, as you've seen me getting up and leaving throughout the whole day, are well worth the benefit that come with good hydration to our body tissues. Physical therapy, yoga, and other low-impact exercises allow us to feel we have some control in certain aspects of our life. We don't have to give it all away. Taking the scraps left on the table that chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia throw at us, when it is done, it's marauding in our lives, is not acceptable. Body image. Hair loss or hair growth? Any of you had that problem? Which seems to fall out or spring up and happens in all the most undesirable places. It won't grow up here. CFS and FM sufferers must make the body image leap away from the person that used to show up after much preparation. This same amount of preparation it took before chronic fatigue can very easily, if expended after chronic fatigue, use up all the energy and enjoyment needed to show up at the interaction or event. Find less energy expending ways of cleaning up, dressing up, and showing up. For example, place a plastic chair in the bathroom. At least place one in the shower to decrease the expended energy it takes to stand while taking a shower. If there is no room for a chair, then sit on the floor with a freestanding mirror in front of you while you blow your hair or put your makeup on. If it's not you they have come to see, then maybe the energy needed to maintain the contact is not worth the effort required. We must learn and practice self-care to survive these chronic illnesses. Pain. Do you have the rest of the day? Let's start with pain trigger points that, when touched, can do us in for hours, if not for the rest of the day, and create nausea that makes chemotherapy nausea blush. Pain is constant, yet transitory in most CFS and FM patients. Guys, I have worked with end-stage cancer patients and end-stage AIDS patients for the majority of my career. For the majority of these end-stage patients, they have less pain and nausea and general body pain than CFS and FM sufferers. And I am in no way minimizing the horribleness of either one of these severely ill populations. I am only trying to stress the reality of the overwhelming symptomatology and discomfort related to this illness and the pain that accompanies its diagnosis. Many activities, once I start them and become involved in them, allow me to leave or dissociate from the pain while engaged in them. For example, what's happening right now with you. Pain often is at its worst at the onset or before the activity or interaction begins, due to our anxiety about what will be required of us in the interaction. In other words, often what stops us is the anticipatory grief of what will happen to us in the interaction. But if we can get through it, or allow ourselves to move through the beginning stages, get through that Harry Potter craziness at the beginning, I did enjoy it an hour into the movie. But don't ask me what was going on the first hour. We often wonder if we will be able to tolerate or participate in the contact or activity if we start it, or our anxiety and fear often convinces us that we cannot or will not be able to be present throughout the time needed. Normal body and brain chemicals that are emitted with interaction and conversation can and do help us with these situations if we will but allow them and ride out the first few uncomfortable minutes and fears. In other words, the catecholamines, the endorphins, the oxytocin, the vasopressin, all those wonderful neurochemistries that work within us and neurochemicals are often, we don't allow them because we're so fearful that we're not going to function. Allow yourself to function even impaired because we don't allow ourselves to then have those normal neurochemicals, those functional neurochemicals that become absent because of our fear. Sleep problems. Now these are symptoms that take a great deal of getting used to, eh? Sleep problems occur when we try to go to sleep, stay asleep, wake up from sleep, avoid sleep, or anything having to do with sleep. They cause restless sleep, too much sleep, unrefreshing sleep, painful sleep, leg cramps, jerking legs, restless leg, and sleep apnea. Sleep is a nightmare. Many patients never again have sleep like they did before they got this disease. I often think, if I could only have one night of sleep like I used to have, just one, just give it to me, please. Without Ambien. And if I take Ambien, you know what happens to me? Then I'm gone the rest of the day. My patients go, I know he's there, but he's not here. You know, his body's there, but his brain is someplace else. CFS and FM cause the body to slow down in its ability to react to normal body rhythms of sleep and awake states. If we can aid the body in waking up slowly in the morning and create gentle physical movements before we get out of bed in the morning, we are far more successful in having a better morning experience. Don't just jump up in the morning. Do exercises in the bed. Start at your legs and move all the way up slowly until you're doing at least a 30-minute regime of gentle, low-stress stretching to allow yourself to get up. And then when you get up, your body goes, I think I can stand on my feet for a while. I will try this. So keep it up. Move it in. Low impact activity program each morning. Sleep difficulties also interfere with intimacy, sexual desire, and create a new conflictual orientation to the bedroom. We end up not liking the bedroom because that's where we have to spend so much of our time. That was once not present. Spouses and partners can pick up on this conflictual orientation sometimes before we realize a change has occurred. I know individuals that say, I will have sex with you anywhere except in my bed. Because that bed I don't like. I don't like what happens there. I don't sleep there. And then the spouse is going, are you interested? And they go, not in the bed. And I don't mean anywhere but the bed. Infections or allergies, let's talk about that. Does it ever feel like you just get done with one infection when this disease you have seems to transmigrate to yet even another organ, bone, joint, or body system, and the inflammation, pain, and dysfunction of the new area it has gone to starts yet another infection, limitation in movement, or disorder that now has to run its course? The longer we suffer with this disease process, the more astute we seem to become. We seem to learn what the migration process of this disease is all about and how it works in our body differently than it does in any other person's body with the disease. We also learn from these chronic continuous experiences with pains, infectious feelings, and system invasion, what we need to get medical treatment for, and which of them will pass in time. This improves. I've had the disease for 18 years, and now I know. I can say, not going to have to see the doctor for this one. Or, yep, going to have to see the doctor for this one. And often, I just walk in, and my primary care doctor says, what do you need? Because you know it better than I know it. You've lived with it for 18 years. In the early stages of the disease, we often react more deeply and feel we need medical help more frequently than we find we do later on in our personal life cycle with living with CFS. Low-grade fevers or low body temperatures, sinus infection, sore throats, mouth sores, tender or swollen lymph nodes, hay fever, hives, rashes, asthma, bronchitis, coughs, tooth pain, abscesses, irritable bowel syndrome, or teeth dying are all frequent symptoms and inflammatory complications with CFS. I know many people with CFS and fibromyalgia that have had numerous root canals since the onset of the disease. We do not get the appropriate oxygenation to the gum tissues that you used to get. It impairs that. So you get dying teeth. Great news, huh? Great news. Heart and respiratory. I'm almost done, guys. Almost can go home. Well, you can go home now if you want to. Don't make me keep you. I know of no patient with this disease that does not experience moderate to high concern about the multiplicity of heart and lung-related symptoms they experience associated with chronic fatigue. Many have said to me they experience, on average, 3 to 4 times each month classical symptoms we medically relate to heart-related illness, such as arm pain, jaw pain, chest pain, pain between the shoulder blades and the back, sweating with these symptoms, an increase or decrease pulse rate, lower high blood pressure, irregular heart rate, trouble breathing or shortness of breath. Many pains associated with chronic fatigue and CFS are under the arm, down the arm, across the chest, in the ribs, or in the intercostal pain situated or occurring between the ribs, or joint pain. It is very normal to have these feelings, but it is crucial to understand and learn which of these symptoms we might experience that are part of the disorder and rule out the feeling that we are in mortal danger or in a medical emergency when indeed we may not be. On December 24th, I was in choir practice. I couldn't breathe. I thought, CFS. I had crushing pain to my chest. CFS. I had pain down my arm. CFS. I started sweating in the forehead and on my neck. CFS. And then I thought, I think I'm having a heart attack. I got in the car and drove home, 15 minutes, took my blood pressure, 160 over 130, my heart rate was 160, I was having a heart attack. I stand before you with 2 stents in my chest saying, be careful. My wife said, why didn't you call the ambulance? I said, I experience those every week. That's a true story. Respiratory discomfort and nasal and sinus irritation can be alleviated by clean, moist, and non-fragranced air. Try a humidifier and an air purification system that is positioned near where you sleep or where you spend the majority of your time during the day. Air quality and air purity can increase the quality of your experience significantly with this disorder. Bladder and kidney discomfort and disease can also accompany the above symptoms. Hormone disruption, let's talk about that quickly, and then I'll wrap up. Hormone disruption like hot flashes, herpes virus outbreaks, poor sexual functioning and low libido adds to the complication that already exists socially and emotionally with all the losses that accompany this disorder. Low testosterone levels can lead to lack of sexual desire and can be regulated and treated by qualified medical providers. Erectile dysfunction medication can help and allow for more satisfactory sexual activity. However, in big red quotations, however, the GI side effects that accompany erectile dysfunction medication, heart rate increases, and the reality these medications create in penile functioning can create emotional as well as cognitive changes in the user regarding sexual behavior. For example, some patients complain that sexual activity with erectile dysfunction medication on board becomes the new standard of performance for them. Sexual activity without the medication can be then viewed as substandard after the medication had been introduced. In other words, the functioning increases, but they feel another loss because they say, now I feel like I don't feel like I can have sex without Viagra or Levitra on board. When this occurs, sex can become a task orientation or create performance anxiety rather than that act as a lovemaking and affectionate act. Many healthy hormones and neurochemicals are released with sexual activity that are not released in any other way, which can create states of well-being, elation, and attachment. In other words, sex can be a positive neuro and body chemical release in living with CFIDS. If you can have sex, enjoy it. I said enough. Blood disorders such as anemia, blood clots, excess bleeding, bruising, varicose veins often accompany CFIDS. 16, neurological concentration and attention deficits, poor attention and concentration, fainting and falling. I've done them all. CFIDS patients experience these neurological symptoms and structural problems, which can be transitory in nature, however, are very troublesome in almost every circumstance. Many of these complicated and concerning symptoms are not as transparent to others as they seem to be to us. They appear to be so apparent to us that sufferers wonder how family and loved one don't recognize our inabilities and concentration problems immediately. Some activities trigger neurological and cognitive symptoms more than others, such as trying to balance checkbooks, look up numbers in a phone directory, or try and read the phone directory for a plot. Someone got it. Do math facts, or locate any given item on a shelf at a grocery store. If you want fibro fog, just put me in the soap aisle of any grocery store. What was once the simple task of making reservations or a doctor's appointment can create or trigger fibro fog so dense we wonder if our minds will ever clear. Chemical involvement in commercial cleaning supplies, deodorizers, sprays, perfumes, and other chemical exposure can also create these symptoms. Find out what is doing it and avoid them. Stop using certain chemicals in your home. It will destroy you if you don't. Don't mix chemicals. I recall my 10th years of having chronic fatigue. going into the kitchen to get a fork to eat some vegetables for one of my small meal choices. When I found my return to the chair, I had a pot scrubber in my hand. At first, I turned to my family and turned this embarrassing moment into a laugh and said, well, I'm glad I'm at home instead of driving a 14-wheeler on the interstate. Later, the reality set in, accompanied with fear that my next step might be an assisted living facility. These episodes increased until I was putting the milk away in the cupboard, writing wrong information on bills and having them returned to me, forgetting what and where I was going midway to my destination, and an inability to remember at times where I was going when driving. I remember going up to the university to pick my daughter one night, and I sat in the car weeping because I couldn't remember why I came over there and what I was doing at the university. After that, I stopped driving for 3 years, literally. These behaviors were very upsetting and caused many days of fear and despair. Know when it's time to stop driving. I didn't drive for 3 years. That's very isolating, but I promise I saved many lives on this. Making a left turn into traffic became totally impossible for me to do. I wondered if I would ever drive again. Many of these losses experienced in my first 10 years living with CFIDS have been returned to me in the second 10 years living with this disease. My primary relationships, which grew distant and painful, have returned to me, and having deepened from living through the chronicity of the disease and learning to cherish that which I almost lost. When loved ones become so chronically ill as we are, family members and friends often distance themselves in preparation for what they see as a possible permanent loss. Now that I have made it 18 years, many of those who appeared to be going away have returned because they realize this illness probably will not take me and I'm not going to go anywhere fast. As one of my family members said, Dad, it's hard to kill a weed. Some did leave because the person I was no longer available and was no longer there. Those who went away, the loss is permanent, painful, and very real. And the adjustment and living without them has been difficult, like it's been with you. People go away because of the impairment. Others around us are not always aware of the lapses we are experiencing in concentration and other symptoms that accompany these neurological deficits. For those of us who have suffered from this disease for decades, we can wave these bothersome things at us. Oh, I'm having a senior moment. For those of you that are younger, you can say, I'm having a CFIDS moment, okay? Maintain your power over these symptoms and allow yourself to state, this is something that is happening to me, not something that I am or have become. These symptoms can and will change, and it doesn't mean that my brain will never think clearly again and that irreparable damage has taken place in our minds from which we cannot recover some function. Many of CFS and FM sufferers do return and have a life after chronic disease. I would like to just cover two more areas. Dizziness can and does happen at many given times, yet it is accompanied often with other symptoms. I have mentioned earlier, when anxiety is high, dizziness is a close bedfellow. When I walk in the supermarket down the soap aisle, Dizziness is a constant companion, accompanied with immediate fibro fog, which for me retreats only when I get out of that environment. If I sit next to the perfumed lady at church, I'm dead for a day. And I mean dead. We must expect it, and now we will get through it. Cleaning with almost any cleanser does it to me. Dizziness also takes place because there's a problem that takes place in our blood vessels. They don't contract appropriately to push the blood back up to our hearts to get it appropriately oxygenated. It's a real problem, folks. So when we're dizzy, go, okay, come on, work. Oxygenate, get it back up. You know, that's why I keep shifting from the chair to standing, because I keep wanting to make myself believe I'm still alive. Transient numbness and weakness, strange roving body sensations are almost a part of this disease. These are worrisome at first, usually are fairly transient and go away. I want to close by talking about depression, anxiety, panic attacks, obsessive and compulsive thoughts. Depression and anxiety are universal aspects of chronic illness. If you have chronic illness, you have depression and anxiety. We all grow through so many losses with this disease process. We become angry at its unrelenting push and pull through every aspect of our physical and emotional well-being. These neurological and cognitive symptoms seem to never leave us alone, and there is no aspect of life that they do not touch or reach. The disease process creates depression and anxiety as it affects our cognitive, physiological, and emotional structures. In many CFIDs and FM sufferers, depression and anxiety are secondary processes, not primary. These are symptoms associated with the disease process that negatively influence our happiness and life. They are secondary to the disease process. As stated earlier, depression, anxiety, and obsessive compulsive disorders are similar to CFS in the fact that they want to take over as much as of you as your and of your life that you are willing to relinquish to them. These robbers of well-being and function are not content until they have occupied every square inch you will allow them to inhabit. We must battle these invaders and put up the fight of our lives for our sakes and the future of our cause. The more we yield to them, the more they win. Depression and anxiety will take every bit of territory you will allow them to take. Our brains, neurological functioning, and emotions are not trying to destroy us, I promise you. It is just the nature of the beast and how it will lie, manipulate, subtly creep, invade, and just wait for the most opportune time to remind us of all of our losses, its victories, and our perceived helplessness before this illness. I say to you as I say daily to myself, I have CFIDS, but I am not CFIDS. I have pain, but I am not my pain. I have weakness, but I am strong. Thank you.